you're playing like whack-a-mole with your race car, except you don't want to hit the moles because they're kids. Every person in the United States, maybe most people in the world, know what the Indy 500 is. It's one of the most famous car races in the world and has been for a century. And so people are fans of the 60s and the 70s and the 80s and the current cars. And I was fortunate enough to come into contact with a very early Indy car, which really sparked my interest in these amazing early machines. When I worked at Canepa, we took an exchange at the museum from the Indianapolis Museum. They brought in a 1926 Miller 91 Indy car. And I was smitten. I got to sit in it. I've got to sit in all the cars, but some of them were more special than others. This was incredible. Back in the day, and we're talking about the 20s, most of the racetracks in the United States were made out of wood. They were quarter mile, half mile wood tracks with banked corners, kind of like the old bicycle velodromes. And they would drive around these things at the craziest of speeds. We're talking 120, 130 miles an hour. The Miller 91 is a very unique vehicle. It's front wheel drive. They made some rear wheel drive versions, but the front wheel drive version was tremendously special. It had a gearbox and differential and everything stuffed right at the front. Then an inline 8-cylinder engine with a supercharger. And it was only 1.5 liters. It was 91.5 cubic inches. And it would put out between 200 and 300 horsepower. So that's 3 horsepower per square inch. Like, these things were bonkers. And when you sat in it, it's just a cockpit in front of your face, little piece of metal across the top that you might be able to duck in front of, and then open sides. Your elbows are 9 inches away from these balloon tires spinning at God speeds, right? It had a traditional pedal setup, but the brake pedal only operated the front brakes. The rear brakes were on a lever on your right, shifter on your left. So if you wanted to shift and brake simultaneously, you'd take your hands off the giant steering wheel. It's a terrifying machine to sit in when it's not moving. I can only imagine what it would be like going at speed, hearing that supercharger whining. So these guys would ramp them up around these tracks, stacked on top of each other at 100 and something miles an hour. And the board tracks would decay as they were driving on them. They're outdoor. So bits of wood would come flying up. And they'd wear like a leather kind of helmet, linen helmet, with some goggles. And the shards of the track would come up and embed themselves in their foreheads, which would go through your skin and hit your skull. And they'd have to pull out with some pliers at pit stops. I'm telling you, there should have been a giant hole in the seat for their enormous balls. Like, they are incredible. Now imagine you're racing around it. There's holes opening up, which happened all the time. So you're trying to slide around this wood track, avoiding holes. And to add to all that, it was a common pastime for young children to crawl underneath the track and stick their heads up through the holes in the track. So then you're playing like whack-a-mole with your race car, except you don't want to hit the moles because they're kids at 100 and something miles an hour with no protection or seatbelt, sliding around a bunch of wood. Indianapolis was totally different. Indianapolis was made on brick, and it's this enormous rectangle, basically. 3.2 million bricks is what it made up of. And racing there was very different. But in order to win the championship, which was sponsored by AAA, yeah, the AAA that Grandpa, his car is insured with, that AAA used to run the races back in the day. You'd have to win dirt track, you'd have to win board racing, and you'd have to win Indy. This particular Miller 91 that I had the privilege to be around was owned by one of the most fascinating characters ever, and his name was Leon Duret. Except his name was not Leon Duret, it was George Stewart. He started racing in kind of a festival circuit around fairgrounds and to be a French driver was pretty fashionable, so they gave him the name Duré. Except when they came to New Orleans and they met real French people that were diplomats from France, asked him to speak French and he couldn't, got in a whole lot of trouble, so he had to legally change his name to Leon Duré to stay out of jail. Everybody wore white. He normally wore black with a white belt, and he had this great mustache, and he was called the Black Devil, and he painted the car black, and he played the kind of high-speed, roguish villain, which he kind of really was. And he went and bought this Miller 91 from Miller 1926. It was the state-of-the-art car. It was $15,000, which in today's money is about $220,000. So racing's never been cheap. He had every intention of winning. In fact, he held the record until 1990 for the most placements in Indianapolis 500 at 5, until 1990, but I think Rick Mears broke that record. In fact, he broke a ton of records, but nobody's ever really heard of him. He brought that car in 1928 after working it out to Indy, and what he had added onto it was his own intercooler to increase the power. An intercooler is a way of cooling the air that's coming out of the really hot supercharger before it gets into the engine, which makes the air and fuel denser, makes it faster. He designed this crazy fin thing that hanged out the side, added to the already brilliant Miller engine, and he could wick it up close to 300 horsepower. Now, when they tested these engines originally, they were like 200. They asked Duré how much horsepower he had in his car. He says, "How much do you want?" Because they would just turn the boost up on the supercharger. Now, he never won the Indy. He took pole twice, I believe. But his character was that of, I'm going to drive hard and fast, and if it blows up or explodes or hit the wall, who cares? And he did that a lot. But the way he played it was brilliant, because he would go lash out the front and just supercharger whining. Everybody thinks he's the best. He's waving to the girls in the crowd. And he blows it up, comes into the pits, and this is where he was smart. He'd grab the press, and he'd be one of the first guys to start working sponsors. He'd talk about his sponsors, he'd get a cocktail and a cigar and grab a girl and talk to the press, and he'd have them all to himself while the race is going on. And the winner, yeah, they'd come along at some point. So he was able to like really fund his things through these kind of exploits. Now, to give you an idea what Indy was like to drive back then, it was usually, it's Memorial Day, it's hot, you're driving the whole distance, usually alone, although you were allowed back then to have another driver come in because you could be exhausted. But the vibration from the steering wheel would rip the skin off of your hands. So even with gloves on, these guys' hands would be bleeding. They come in with bandages. And the bumping, you imagine what it's like. If you've ever been over just a rough road, imagine going over bricks that are sitting in Indiana, going up and down in the winter and summer, 3 million of them, the bouncing that's going on for hour after hour. And the Millers stood up to it. In fact, through that period, 83% of the cars racing at Indy were Millers. It was the car to run. Before that, Duesenberg had done great things. They actually came out with the supercharger. Miller perfected the supercharger. When the cars were eventually changed, the rules changed at Indy about engine size and things like that. In 29, you couldn't run the Millers anymore. He got sponsorship from the Packard Cable Company to buy another Miller front drive car, the only 1929 one, I believe, and a rear drive car. So he took three cars on a tour of Europe to show off front wheel drive technology and their sponsor and everything. So he goes to France. And again, Duré's nature is just to go to fast as he possibly can. So on a track outside of Paris, he sets two world records, speed records, with his front drive Miller 91. And then proceeds to go down to Italy to the Grand Prix at Monza. Very, extremely famous, prestigious race. His car is not designed. None of these cars are designed for the road circuits of Monza. Because Indy and board tracking doesn't require a whole lot of braking and doesn't require a whole lot of turning right. Even with that, he set the lap record at Monza in a Miller 91. Oh, he broke it. And he terrified people because he couldn't slow down for the corners. because the car really doesn't have any brakes. Downshifting would blow it up. So the only thing he had was he'd go into a corner and just chuck it sideways and use the slideways skid to slow him down. And all these Grand Prix European drivers are like, what the? Because in front of him, this car suddenly twitching sideways. And they wanted to kick him out of the race. But that wasn't a concern because he just blew himself up. He blew all of them up. It caught the attention of Ettore Bugatti, who at that point was building the fastest Grand Prix cars in Europe. And he saw how fast these Millers were. What they thought of American cars back then was really, they thought we were still cowboys and Indians. They had no conception that our cars were that quick. He was blown away. So he goes up to DeRay and goes, I want to buy your cars. And DeRay's like, what are you offering me? And he goes, I will give you 3 Bugattis and a whole bunch of cash. That's what I got. And DeRay was no idiot, was like, sure, you want 3 broken Millers? Here you go. And he takes the Millers and he takes them back to his factory. And what he did was reverse engineer the brilliant Miller engine, the Bugatti Model 50 and 51 racing engine, which came out about a year later or so, looked very similar to a Miller 91. Overhead camshafts, very, very similar. Not identical, but like, we saw what you did. And then the cars disappeared. DeRay would go on to a kind of lackluster career after that. But what people were really wondering is what happened to the 2 Millers. Bugatti struggled through the war and came out the other side and eventually went out of business. When they were taking the factory apart, and I mean apart, they were like, pulled up the floorboards. And under the floor are 2 Miller 91 front drive cars with their engines sitting right next to them, perfectly preserved. Somebody had hid them there from the Nazis during the war and forgotten about it. They made 12, 13 of these cars, and I think 6 still exist. But the ones that mostly exist are an engine they built a car around or a chassis they built an engine for. These 2 cars are the only complete original Miller 91 front drive Indy cars. American Swedish journalist went over and he literally wrote the book on Millers. He went over there and negotiated it in 1959 and he brought them back to the United States. Had them restored, one in the Smithsonian and one at the Indy Museum. The Indy Museum was the car I got to sit in.
This time of year, I know a lot of us are trying to clean out our garages and maybe get rid of some things that we probably don't need. So if there's an extra set of wheels and tires sitting over in the corner, or an exhaust that you forgot to install, or a part you bought 2 of and forgot about that too, the best place to sell them is on ModFind. And likewise, if you're trying to find a part, new, used, aftermarket OEM for your car, truck, project, whatever, the best place to shop for those is also on ModFind. ModFind is a free app that you can download in the Android or iOS store, and that will allow you to buy, sell, transact, whatever you want to do, a car, a part, a tool, anything related to the automotive hobby. It also allows you to create a listing and then add a kickback to incentivize your followers to share it with their followers. They make it very easy to share to all the major social platforms, and we'd like to thank them for their support of VinWiki this month. Please go download their app today, buy, sell your parts. A few of mine are already listed there, and it's a great platform, and I cannot wait to see where they go from here.